prosperity, providing capabilities for people to flourish. And of course, this task has material dimensions. It would be nonsense to talk about people flourishing if they didn't have food, clothing, and shelter. But it's also clear that prosperity goes beyond this. It has social and psychological aims: family, friendship, commitment, society, participating in the life of that society. And this, too, requires investment. Investment, for example, in places where we can connect, places where we can participate, shared spaces, concert halls, gardens, public parks, libraries, museums, quiet centers, places of joy and celebration, places of tranquility and contemplation, sites for the cultivation of a common citizenship, in Michael Sandel's lovely phrase. And investment, after all, is just such a basic economic concept, is nothing more nor less than a relationship between the present and the future, a shared present and a common future. And we need that relationship to reflect, to reclaim hope. So let me come back with this sense of hope to the 2 billion people still trying to live each day on less than the price of a skinny latte from the cafe next door. What can we offer those people? It's clear that we have a responsibility to help lift them out of poverty. It's clear that we have a responsibility to make room for growth, where growth really matters in those poorest nations. And it's also clear that we will never achieve that unless we're capable of redefining a meaningful sense of prosperity in the richer nations, a prosperity that is more meaningful and less materialistic than the growth-based model. So this is not just a Western post-materialist fantasy. In fact, an African philosopher wrote to me when Prosperity Without Growth was published, pointing out the similarities between this view of prosperity and the traditional African concept of Ubuntu. Ubuntu says, "I am because we are." Prosperity is a shared endeavor. Its roots are long and deep. Its foundations, I've tried to show, exist already inside each of us. So this is not about standing in the way of development. It's not about overthrowing capitalism. It's not about trying to change human nature. What we're doing here is we're taking a few simple steps towards an economics fit for purpose. And at the heart of that economics, we're placing a more credible, more robust, and more realistic vision of what it means to be human. Thank you very much.
While they're taking the podium away, just a quick question. I mean, first of all, economists aren't supposed to be inspiring, so you may need to work on the tone a little. can you picture the politicians ever buying into this? I mean, can you picture a politician standing up in Britain, say, and saying, GDP fell 2% this year, good news. We're actually all happier, and our country is more beautiful, and our lives are better.
Well, that's clearly not what you're doing. You're not making news out of things falling down. You're making news out of the things that tell you that we're flourishing. Can I picture politicians doing it? Actually, I already am seeing a little bit. When we first started this kind of work, politicians would stand up, Treasury spokesmen would stand up and accuse us of wanting to go back and live in caves. And actually, in the period through which we've been working over the last 18 years, partly because of the financial crisis and a little bit of humility in the profession of economics, actually people are engaging in this issue in all sorts of countries around the world.
But is it mainly politicians who are going to have to get their act together, or is it going to be more just civil society and companies?
It has to be companies, it has to be civil society, but it has to have political leadership. This is a kind of agenda which actually politicians themselves are kind of caught in that dilemma because they're hooked on the growth model themselves. But actually opening out the space to think about different ways of governing, different kinds of politics, and creating the space for civil society and businesses to operate differently, absolutely vital.
And if someone could convince you that we actually can make the 130-fold improvement in efficiency, yeah, of reduction of carbon footprint, would you then actually like that picture of economic growth into more knowledge-based goods?
I would still want to know that you could do that and get below zero by the end of the century in terms of taking carbon out of the atmosphere and solve the problem of biodiversity and reduce the impact on land use and do something about the erosion of topsoils and the quality of water. If you can convince me we can do all that, then yes, I would take the 2%.
Tim, thank you for a very important talk. Thank you.
Thank you.